گلشن هر آدو دلا دلا به نور تو تو که باشد روز مبعث هر هر گل دلا روش به تو که باشد روز مبعث ز پا تا سر تمامی در سرور تو که باشد روز مبعث حبیبی یا محمد حبیبی یا محمد حبیبی محمد حبیبی یا محمد حبیبی یا محمد حبیبی پیام این پیامبر به هستی بود یک سر هستی پیام این پیامبر به هستی آهای عالم آهای آدم خدای من خداوند کریم به من فرمود که یا محمود برای من فقط علی عظیمه آهای عالم آهای آدم خدای من خداوند به من فرمود که یا
The old quote goes, don't go where the path may lead, but instead go where there is no path and leave a trail. This sounds 100% perfect and 100% makes sense and accurate. But when it's applied to what we are rejoicing today, then the whole meaning of this quote changes. Today is the day where all the roads, the paths merge and are perfected by what? By the revelations which were revealed on this night. Cultures are transformed, religions are fulfilled, and prophethood is concealed. Respected viewers, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome to tonight's episode here from the Holy Shrine of the Commander of the Faithful, Imam Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam. Before I begin the episode and before I introduce anything, I would like to congratulate you on this very auspicious occasion, the Eid of Al-Mab'ath and Nabawi, where Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came to perfect human race and came to send a message to the entire global community, if you will. Today, inshallah, I am joined by my dear guest or with my dear guest, Sheikh Hashem Al-Ghadeeri. Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh. How are you?
Alhamdulillah,
thank you. Inshallah. I would like to congratulate you on this very special occasion.
Everything goes same to you as well.
Alhamdulillah. Sheikhna, let's kick it off with a simple question. Although it's not very simple, is that why is this day or this night has been given through the traditions that we see, the enormous amount of significance has been placed on this night? Can you tell me why briefly?
Yeah, Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. As Quran says, Allah is the one. لَقَدْ مَنَ اللَّهُ وَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِيهِمْ رَسُولًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ يَتْلُو عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ وَيُعَلِّمُهُمُ الْكِتَابَ وَالْحِكْمَةَ. Allah clarifies the reason in this verse that why this night is made so memorable and why this night is mentioned as a noble night. Allah has sealed his prophethood. The last prophet came and he announces that I'm the last prophet. The Mab'ath doesn't mean that he was appointed as a prophet this day. It doesn't mean that he was nominated as a prophet this day. But he announced himself. He was declared that I am the prophet, the last prophet. Because we believe that prophet was prophet before Adam was born. كنت نبيا وعذو بين الماء والطين.
Yes.
So tonight, wasn't the appointment. It was the information, the announcement of the prophet of Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. And he says that there were mu'mineen before him. لَقَدْ بَنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَى الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ رَسُولًا مِنْ أَنفُسِهِمْ. He there were believers before them. He came, was one of them. And he said, I am the last prophet. He announced it. And of course, the prophet started with the prophet Adam a few thousand years ago. And this prophet had to get an end. The last prophet had to come and who would
to conceal
summarize
it.
All of the prophets, all of the books before him, and he has to be the last one and to conceal, as you said. So this night is made so sanctified and so glorified because Allah wanted us to remember for whole of the generation till the day of Qiyamah that this was the day when I appoint, when I announced the last prophet. So you would remember that who was the last prophet? Khatam al-Nabi Jin. So when he came and said, I am the prophet, the last prophet, because there is no prophet to come after him. The Isa, we don't know when he was appointed or when he was announced. The Isa, the Musa, the prophet, we don't know about it. The history only remembers the Prophet Muhammad. Why? Because there is no prophet after him. So this night or this day is remembered because there is no one going to come after Muhammad. So mm-hmm. we must remember this night. Whoever remembers mm-hmm. this night, he will believe that there is no prophet coming after Muhammad.
Mm-hmm. Now, I mean, from the amount of people, just to let the dear viewers know, from the amount of people that are here in the Holy Shrine, makes it seem like it's the birthday of someone. Really makes it seem like it's the birthday of Rasulullah or Imam Ali. I remember a couple of days ago, or 10 days ago, we were here on the birth of Imam Ali al-Talib alayhi salam, and honestly, it wasn't as packed as right now. So we can say that it's the birth of Islam. It's although, as you mentioned, Prophet Muhammad was there before Adam. You know, the Islam was there. The religion of all the prophets that came before Prophet Muhammad. But as I was searching up and I was asking people, trying to get surveys of how many people know about this occasion. A lot of people do, but they always mix it up with another occasion, Isra wal Mi'raj, where the ascension basically. What is the difference between Al-Mab'ath al-Nabawi and Isra wal-Mi'raj?
Your question has two parts. Let me answer the first one.
Yes.
Why we see so many people here inside the Shrine of Imam Ali? Islam was born, we can say now, Islam was announced, Islam was declared today, whatever you want to call it. But why we don't see this many people inside the Shrine of Prophet Muhammad, rather than we
yeah.
see really, the reason behind it, there's a reason
that's,
behind it.
That's
yeah,
a point.
There's a point. Prophet came to announce that all the prophets that were before him, all the books and all the religions that God sent, they're protected today. And after this, there would be no harm to Islam, there would be no harm to the message of Allah, etc. Similarly, why we see people here? Why we see people coming here to Qajr Imam Ali alayhi salam on the day of Mab'ath? Because as Prophet was the last Prophet, and a protector of the religions before him, Imam Ali was the protector of Islam. So as Mab'ath sealed the prophethood, similarly Ghadeer sealed up Islam. So this is the reason people
see
coming.
we're emerging
yeah.
two things
yeah,
to, yeah,
two
okay.
together. So this is the reason people are coming towards Imam Ali mm-hmm. to pay contribution to him, to say salutation to him, to say congratulation to him. Why? Because whatever the role of the Prophet Muhammad is amongst all the Anbiya, this is the role of same role Imam Ali has among Islam. This is number one. Number two is the difference between today and the night of Isra. They are two totally different occasions. One has to
they are, together. But a lot of people tend to yeah. put them together.
The problem is that there are two traditions. There are two traditions.
Yes.
Our Sunni
two different dates.
Two different days. Sunni brothers believe that tonight is the night of Isra. We had Shia believe that tonight is the night
of Mab'ath. Yeah.
But of course, Sayyid Tabatabai, Muhammad Sayyid Tabatabai, Sahib al-Mizan, he said that the most probably night that Prophet went to Isra on Miraj is 17th of Ramadan.
Yes.
One is 23rd of Ramadan. And he said that it is harsh to believe that Prophet went to Miraj less than once, or less than twice, or more than once. So you see, he believes that Prophet, at minimum, he went to Miraj twice. So in our religion, in Shiism, we believe that Prophet did not go to Miraj on this night. It is Mab'ath night. That he went to Miraj was the 17th of Ramadan or 23rd of Ramadan, not today.
Mm-hmm.
And the ayat that reflects the Miraj is Subhanallah Yasra bi Abdihi Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa. And that was one night. So within one night, Prophet went from Masjid Ram al-Masjid al-Aqsa alladhi barakna hawlahu linuriyahu min ayatina. And the reason why Prophet was sent to Miraj was taken to Miraj so that Allah could show him his ayat, his symbol, his signs.
Mm-hmm.
And there's one tradition from Imam, he says that Nahnu Ayatullah.
Yes.
We are the ones that Prophet saw us on the night,
yes,
of Isra.
Yes.
So this is just a misconception, misunderstanding of the majority of Muslims, that they mixed these two events. One has nothing to do with the other.
Mm-hmm.
Abbas is totally different even than the Isra. And this is unfortunately that we have mixed it. But of course, until we have the teaching of Ahlul Bayt, we will not let them mix.
Yeah. And another point that actually, if we can, you know, put them all together, as if we look at the verse, Subhanallah Asra bi Abdihi Layla, that verse, the first verse of Surah Al-Isra, we would realize that this is not actually the first verse that was revealed.
Yeah.
We would see that there's a lot of revelations before that, where Eid Al-Mab'ath is the nights where the Prophet was just being, Archangel Jibreel came down to him and said, now you're a prophet.
Yeah.
Although he was a prophet,
yeah,
but he says, now begin your mission.
Yeah.
Now your mission begins. Should you choose to accept it,
yeah,
as Mission Impossible would say, you know? But yes, the Prophet, of course, accepted the mission. But another idea, though, if we want to come, you mentioned how in Islam, before Prophet Muhammad brought Islam, and then Imam Ali was the one who protected Islam,
yeah,
the first part of the answer, you answered to the question.
Yeah.
Now, a lot of people would say that, in what way does Islam need to be protected? I mean, Islam is really out there, and everyone should understand it the way that Prophet Muhammad came, brought it forth. You know, the Quran should be self-evident, self-explanatory. Why should there someone be to protect it? Isn't a divine protecting it?
Well, of course, there's a divine protection. That's why we are living,
and
we are called Muslim.
But a lot of people, this question, yeah, has been raised many times.
Yeah, because if there was no divine protection, probably would be Allah Azza wa Jalla Yazidi, will be following some Yazid of some times. Because I told you last time that there are two versions of Islam. One is hijacked Islam, that we have nothing to do with Islam, the real Islam. And one is a real Islam.
Yeah.
There are very small numbers of following people there. But yeah, it does exist. The divine protection is there, of course, and there's all been two forces, the divine force and certain forces.
Yes.
There have all been two forces. Even the first human being, Adam alayhi salam, he had two sons. One was following Islam or the Prophet Adam's mission, the other one was following Satan.
Yeah.
So these two forces had there since the time, the start of the time, and they are still conceiving till today. As I told you, there are two faces of Islam.
Yes.
This is our personal duty to find out and search and look for the real Islam.
Yes.
Once Imam Ali was asked that, what if we live in a time where we don't know where is Haq?
Yes.
Imam Ali said, in every time, our Haq will be as bright as you see the sun in the midday. No matter how many forces, evil forces come, there will be no one to hide the real Haq. So our Haq, the haq of Allah, will be as bright as the sun you see in the midday.
Mm-hmm.
So it's our personal duty,
mm-hmm,
my brother and sister, it's our personal duty to look for the real Islam. That Allah has protected Islam.
Yes.
It is there. Inni tarikun feekum mustaqalan kitabullahi wa itrati
alabaykum
ma in tamassaktum behima. So there are two conditions, there are two things, the book and the Ahlul Bayt. If you leave book, just follow Ahlul Bayt, probably you will lose. Or if you just take the Quran, hasbuna kitabullah, and leave Prophet and the family, you will lose.
Well, technically, if you're following Ahlul Bayt, you're following the Quran.
Of course.
But if you follow only the Quran needs explanatory. Someone there to explain what the verses mean.
Of course.
I mean, we humans, our brains are limited. The way we think is limited. We need someone there to guide us. You know, that's why we have leaders.
Yeah.
You know, that lead certain nations and so on and so forth. Speaking of Isra and Mi'raj, speaking how Islam needs to be protected, a lot of misconceptions are revolved around the Mab'ath al-Nabawi. For example, him being in the cave and, you know, so on and so forth, how Jibreel came on to him. And this misconception isn't really, you know, why isn't there any witnesses to this incident? A lot of people do raise this question. This question was actually inboxed to me on Facebook today, is that since the Prophet, yes, everybody believed in him because no one at that time could bring what the Prophet brought. But why weren't there any witnesses for the Prophet to, you know, for example, if a revelation, the Prophets before Islam, they were known as Prophets because when they're in the middle of the people, they begin to receive revelations.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But the Prophet began in a cave. It's different than the rest of the Prophets.
Yeah, well, this is just the first ayah that was revealed when he was in the cave.
Yes.
I think all of the other ayahs that were revealed, he was amongst the people.
Yes.
And that's why Imam Ali said that there is no ayah that was revealed on the top of the mountain or inside the war ground. I know the meaning of it. So there are verses that are revealed on different places.
Yes.
This very particular ayah, the verses that was revealed inside the cave, I believe as a test. This is a test as well. For the people, because Prophet himself has introduced with his character that people, even the kuffar, the mushrikeen used to call him Sadiq and Amin.
Yes.
So it was the test for them that if you had been calling him a Sadiq, if you actually meant him being a Sadiq, then believe him what he's saying. So each and every single step of the Prophet, it was a test for the Ummah.
Yes.
So when he came down and said, I am the Prophet, and Allah just, whatever, asked me as a Prophet.
Yeah.
So the people had to believe him. If they actually believed him as a Sadiq, they would have believed him, yes, mm-hmm. because he was Sadiq. And as I mentioned last time, that when he went to the for the Dawatul Ashira, and he said, if I told you that there is an army of enemy coming from the top of this mountain, from the back of the mountain, will you believe it? They said, yeah, we will believe it. Why?
Yeah.
Because you are Sadiq.
Yes.
And I said, what if you come up and you don't see the army? What do you mm-hmm. say? He said, we will see that we have gone blind, but yes. you are still a Sadiq.
Let's continue that, but after a short break, if you want, inshallah. Sure. Respected viewers, do stay tuned for, inshallah. Come back after the short break.
سخن از عشق ما پیامبر هم پیامبر به صد نغمه به صد آوا سخن از مرتضا گو سخن از مرتضا گو حبیبی یا محمد طبیبی جانم حبیبی حبیبی هر گلشن هر گل دل روشن به نوره که باشد روز مبعث هر گل دل ز نوره تو ز پا تا سر سر تمامی در سرور تو که باشد روز مبعث که باشد روز مبعث یا محمد طبیبی یا محمد حبیبی یا محمد طبیب
همه با هم همه با هم
حبیبی طبیبی هر گلشن هر گل دلا دلا به نور تو تو که باشد روز مبعث هر گل دلا روش تو که باشد روز مبعث ز پا تا سر تمامی در سرور تو که باشد روز مبعث حبیبی یا محمد حبیبی یا محمد حبیبی محمد حبیبی یا محمد حبیبی یا محمد حبیبی پیام این پیامبر به هستی بود یک سر هستی پیام این پیامبر به هستی آهای عالم آهای آدم خدای من خداوند کریم به من فرمود که یا محمود برای من فقط علی عظیمه آهای عالم آهای آدم خدای من خداوند به من فرمود که یا محمود برای من فقط عظیمه حبیبی یا محمد طبیبی حبیبی یا محمد طبیبی
آهای عالم آهای آدم خدای من
من خداوند کریم آهای لم آهای آدم خدای خداوند
به من فرمود که یا محمود برای من
برای من فقط علی عظیمه فقط علی عظیمه فقط علی عظیمه فقط علی
های
فقط علی چه در غار حرا شد
چه اتفاقی افتاد چی گذشت
چه در غار حرا شد که این غوغا به پا شد
چه خبر 1400 ساله چی میگن
چه در غار حرا شد که این خدای راز و بی
ام Respected viewers, welcome back. To mention again and to remind you guys that tonight is the night where the Prophet was, you know, descended upon by Jibra'il, or Jibra'il descended upon Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa sallam on this night where Islam was born, although Islam did exist before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wa sallam. But tonight is the night where that title is placed on that situation. Islam is born. And happy birthday to all the Muslims out there. But we want to continue our discussion revolving around Mab'ath al-Nabawi, which is the eve of today. Now, we came to the question where, we do apologize for that. It's okay, you guys can go by, pass by. Pilgrims, it is crowded. Everyone here is, you know, trying to hustle through the holy shrine. Anyways. In what way does Prophet Muhammad, or in what way did Prophet Muhammad contribute to humanity and modern day societies? Because we do see a lot of, you know, contributions by Prophet Muhammad, and we do see him, you know, perfecting the moral. This is as a mercy and a way of perfection to our morals. It was a perfect example of perfect morals and perfect manners. In what other ways? A lot of people say yes, morals, religion, and you know, protecting and merciful. But we need more something about humanity. We need something that, you know, will make us live in coexistence.
Well, I'm surprised. What else they want? I mean, they got religion, they got morals, they got humanity. What else they want?
See, a lot of people do have the good morals, but don't have the religion. They don't feel like it's a necessity. You know what I mean? But the importance of them, all them together, is what we need. You know what I mean? But it's as a main contribution to humanity and to society. What did he contribute?
Actually, what the main thing that we need to understand is what religion is. Mm-hmm. What religion? What does religion mean? Religion is actually a compilation of law, a guidance, how one should live in society. You cannot have high morals or the divine morals without...
I know, I asked the question and answered it at the same time.
The religion is actually a compilation of the law, a guidance of the law, or how one can live peacefully in society, and how we can coexist in society.
Yes.
The main thing is, this is a very misunderstanding that if there is a Muslim society, a non-Muslim cannot live in. No, Prophet given us the whole of the constitution, how a non-Muslim could live in a Muslim society, how a Muslim should live in a non-Muslim society. There are ways. All we lack is the information. We have not gone through the history of Prophet. We have gone on through the life of Prophet. All we got from Prophet is that he was a Prophet. He married more than 10 women. He had X, Y, Z. But we have not gone through his life and entire first 40 years of Prophet being a Prophet and not announcing the Prophet. In one word, Allah, but they are wasted because we haven't gone through it. We have history, but we don't follow the history. We go straight to the history. Those 40 years are actually the manifest of a person living without religion, because he did not announce that he is a Christian. He didn't say I'm a Jew. He didn't say I'm a Muslim. He didn't say I'm a prophet. But he was living in. So those 40 years are for everyone, whether you are a Christian, whether you are a Jew, whether you are Muslim, or you don't believe any religion.
And that's placed beautifully, because what's so nice about that is he gave the community or the society he was living in the opportunity to know him, who he is truly as a person, and then to know what the religion he's going to bring forth. Perfect example.
And the ayat of Mab'ath was لَقَدْ مَنَّ اللَّهُ ذَا الْمُؤْمِنِينَ إِذْ بَعَثَ فِي مُسْلِمِنَ فِسْلِمْ يَتْلُوا عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتِهِ وَيُزَكِّيهِمْ.
Yes.
He purifies them. And there's one ayat that هُوَ الَّذِي أَرْسَلَ رَسُولَهُ بِالْهُدَى وَدِينِ الْحَقِّ.
Yes.
First, he was given
as
the hidayah,
yes,
the guidance. So those 40 years, in my opinion, those 40 years are the summarized the word Huda, because he himself, his character, propagated what he was going to say with his tongue.
Yes.
So we cannot say that Prophet did not give anything to the humanity. Those 40 years are more than enough. As a Muslim, he lived 23 years. After he announced his Prophet, he lived.
Well, let's not say something. Lived as a Muslim for 23 years, but
no,
yes.
I mean,
yes, you know what I mean.
I know what you mean.
A lot of people will probably clip that out and put it as, you know, we're saying that. Yeah.
Of course, there's a saying in our language, Urdu, that if a person is intelligent, he only needs the points, he doesn't need the interpretation. So
yes.
I'm just pointing that after he announced himself being a prophet, he stayed for 22 years only. But before he announced himself being a prophet, he was
doing
40 years. So his contribution, without mentioning him a prophet, is more than what he lived as a prophet. So if we do not let those 40 years go wasted, we can, of course, get a lot of stuff from his life.
Yeah, and that's actually perfect, because one of the main things that a lot of people do talk about is that 40 years, history does mention a lot of it. But for example, when you mention that, you know, 40 years first as a guidance and then brought the religion, a lot of people knew him as a Sadiq al-Amin, as we first stated in today's program. One of the most beautiful things that I like about the story of this 40 years is people really liked Prophet Muhammad more than they liked him after Islam.
Yeah, of course.
Not everyone, but a lot of people, because he was the type of person where this honesty was eliminated from his heart, from his life. Mm-hmm. He was an honest person who lived his life purely. And that's what a lot of people liked about Prophet Muhammad and loved about him.
And before you ask me the question, I must add this. Even after he announced himself being a prophet, those who believed him as Sadiq, they didn't say that you are a liar. We must say that they believed that he was Sadiq before he said that I was a prophet. And they still believe that he was a Sadiq.
Wow.
But they said, we don't follow what you say.
Yes.
But you are still a Sadiq.
Wow.
And the proof of my statement is
yes.
that on the night of Hijrah from Makkah to Medina, the kufar had their amana with them. All the amanat of the kufar and the mushrikeen were kept with Prophet. They had any doubt on him that he was not Sadiq, was not Amin, they would have taken their amana beforehand.
Yes.
Even the night the Prophet said that to Imam Ali to sleep on my bed and tomorrow you return the belongings to the people and join me in Medina. So it means that even the kufar, they didn't follow Islam, they didn't believe in the Prophet, but they never said that you are Qazib. Mm-hmm. They never said you are no more Amin. They still believed him as a Sadiq, as an Amin, but only they didn't want to leave the religion of their forefathers. Mm-hmm. And there are so many traditions, people say that, Muhammad, you are Sadiq, you are Amin, we like you, you never lie, but we do not want to leave the religion of our forefathers. Mm-hmm. So this was the main reason. Not that they hated Prophet Muhammad after him himself announced as a prophet, no.
Yes. Now, one of the questions, you know, your viewers, you can message us on Facebook and add your questions about the topic. One of the questions that I just got about the 40 years before the prophethood of Prophet Muhammad, he's saying that, so basically for 40 years, the Holy Prophet, basically, so for 40 years, the Holy Prophet wasn't a prophet, didn't claim his religion, didn't pronounce his religion, but yeah, he was trustworthy and, you know, as a guidance. Do we need religion to be a guide and to be trustworthy?
Yeah, of course. If we did not need the Prophet, wouldn't do he wouldn't announce it.
But 40 years.
Yeah, the 40, as I said, the 40 years are for those people who are living and following different religions. Those 40 years are for the people who are following different religions. Kufar, Mushrikeen, Yahudi, Nasrani, and all sort of religions.
Yes.
He told them, this is how you should live, no matter what religion you follow. And then he said, now I'm going to show you how you should live as a Muslim. So those 40 years are for general public. No matter what religion you follow, you should never lie. No matter what religion you follow, you should be Amin. No matter what, you have these morals and ethics. And then after 40 years, he gave that, now when you are a complete human being without religion, now come to successful. Man qala la ilaha illallah Muhammad Rasulullah, fawa muslimin. And then say, why we need to say la ilaha illallah when we can live without la ilaha illallah? There's a question, this question,
yes.
We were asking, this is a question.
Yes.
Somebody asked Prophet that, why do we need Allah as a one?
Yes.
Why would we need you as a Prophet when we can live peacefully? Prophet replied, no, you cannot live peacefully if you do not follow Allah. If you don't follow Muhammad, you cannot live peacefully. And he gave examples of all of these kufar mushrikeen and these tribes that they would fight for years and years for the sake of one camel. They would fight, they would kill people, human beings, for the sake of one cow, one camel. Said, this is not what I want. This is not what Allah wants. Allah wants you to give the rights of everyone.
Yes. And see, what I like about that is that this question is sometimes valid. Mm. You know, a lot of people do wonder why, you know, for 40 years the Prophet didn't pronounce his religion. But at the same time, you mentioned a very valid point as well, is that really the situation of the Prophet was different from our situation.
Yeah.
You know, now we do have a guide. Mm. You know, there's no excuse for someone to say that, you know what, I didn't know what this person did or that person did.
Yeah.
So basically, he removed every excuse that a person can think of.
Of course.
For 40 years, as you mentioned, he was known as that person. So he was paving the way into, you know, completing his establishment or completing the divine establishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, before we go into a short break, I know we have like 2 minutes before we go into a short break. If you can add any information about how Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you know, was able to change the mentalities. Before we go into, you know, the last question, the last discussion that we have today, how did he transform this mentality of being so ignorant to being what we have today?
Well, whatever Prophet left, the Quran and Ahlul Bayt. Before he left, it was Quran and himself. So only these two reasons, the words of Allah and the character of Muhammad. I'm going to say again, the words of Allah and the character of Muhammad, peace be upon him and his family. These two things have changed the world. These two things changed the mentality. They used to kill their daughters. And when the daughter of Muhammad was born, he used to respect him in the way that he said, Fatwa the Badato Minni. It's just one example that you should not kill your daughter. Instead, you should respect your daughters. And we see the example in all of his Prophet's life that whenever Fatima Zahra used to come, Prophet used to stand up and respect, welcome her, and used to give her abba, her seat to her. And so she could sit for as long as she wanted, and Prophet would sit next to her. So this is one of the examples that Prophet gave to the world, that this is how you should live. They used to kill each other. They used to go for robbery, for anything you can mention, from the needle to the camel. Prophet said, no, this is not what something makes a human being a perfect human being. Yes. Look at me. I don't follow or I don't announce any religion, that I'm not a mushrik, I'm not a Yahudi, I'm nothing. But I'm not killing anyone. I am alim. He used to recite. There's, just before you go to break, there's this conception that Prophet, when the first religion was revealed.
Let's just finish that because it's getting a little bit crowded.
Sure.
We'll continue after the short break. So respected viewers, do stay tuned for continue our discussion. But after the short break, we do apologize for that. We'll continue after, inshallah.
که وقت به عزت نوره که جشن مبعث احمد همان ولادت نوره بی تو دلم چون شب تاره بی تو جهان نوری نداره هرچی که دارم نظر یاره هرچی که دارم نظر یاره مددی یا رسول الله مددی یا رسول الله مددی یا رسول الله مددی یا رسول الله نظر نما به دل من به قطر قطره اشکم نظر نما به دل من به قطر قطره اشکم نظر به روی سیاهو به سینه پر دردم با تو دلم چون بهاره بی تو دلم چه بیقراره بی تو دلم یاری نداره بی تو دلم یاری نداره با تو دلم چون بهاره بی تو دلم چه بیقراره بی تو دلم یاری نداره بی تو دلم یاری نداره مددی یا رسول الله 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 تمام عالم روشن که وقت بعثت نوره که جشن مبعث احمد همان ولادت نوره تمام عالم روشن که وقت بعثت نوره که جشن مبعث احمد همان ولادت نوره بی تو دلم چون شب تاره بی تو جهان نوری نداره هرچی که دارم نظر یاره هرچی که دارم نظر یاره مددی یا رسول الله مددی یا رسول الله مددی یا رسول الله مددی یا رسول الله نظر نما به دل من به قطر قطره اشکم نظر نما به دل من به قطر قطره اشکم نظر به روی سیاهو
به سینه یه پر درده، با تو دلم چون بهاره، بی تو دلم چه بیقراره، بی تو دلم یاری نداره، بی تو دلم یاری نداره، با تو دلم چون بهاره، بی تو دلم چه بیقراره، بی تو دلم.
Respected viewers, thank you very much once again for tuning in. I would like to congratulate you on this very special occasion, which marks the Eid Al-Mab'ath and Nabawi, the incident where Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought Islam to the entire world and publicly announced his religion after 40 years. Sheikh Al-Aziz, after 40 years. Now, some may say that this is not a specific incident. That, you know, Prophet Muhammad did reveal after 40 years. I think it's enough.
Yeah.
40 years is enough. After, yeah, you know, you need to mention something that, you know, which religion do you follow? So the Prophet did that. And he announced his faith, his religion, whatever you want to call it. Islam, he announced that. That incident, for me, I call it incident because really, when someone comes to reveal something, it's an occasion or an incident arrangement that he arranged with his family members. Yeah. Now, how is a 14-year-old occasion or incident able to solve modern-day problems?
Well,
this is somewhat correlated to the previous question.
Previous question, of course. Just we look at how this Mab'ath or occasion or incident, whatever you want to call it, happens step by step. Prophet used to sit in the Hira cave for so many times.
Yes.
It's not the first time he went there. He used to sit there. It was one of his habits. And one of the Sunni guys used to say that Prophet used to do yoga there, alayhi billah. So he said the Prophet used to do yoga there. Well, that's not local for Kufa Nabashir. That's not our view. But yeah, he said,
wow.
He said because there was nothing to read, there was nothing to do. He was a worship. So how would he would just go himself?
You know, just something funny. That really just felt them. The people that sit in front of him, did they ask him questions like, "Where do you get? Did he wear yoga pants?" You know, astaghfirullah. But
yeah,
I mean, like the people sitting, what goes through their mind?
Yeah. So, this is the mentality of people. Even they claim to be Muslim, they claim to be the following of Prophet, they claim to be understanding Prophet, and still, they come up with this kind of views that he was alayhi doing the yoga. People have not actually understood what actually happened. Prophet Muhammad used to go there. And somebody asked him that after one of the companions, after they started to come to Islam, asked them, what did you used to go there? What did you used to do there? And then Prophet said that when he was asked that there was no Quran, there was no Jibreel, there was no Allah, what would you do there? He said, the Quran wasn't there for you, not for me. Islam wasn't there, not for you, but for me, it was there. The Allah wasn't there for you, but it was for me, he was there. So I used to go there and speak to Allah, used to talk to Allah, do hamdan sana for Allah. And he was asked that, What would you read there? Because there was no Quran. And he said, I used to read Quran. And there is one riwayah, one tradition from Imam Sadiq al-Islam, and he was asked the same question. He was said, do you think that we, Muhammad and the Prophet and the family of Muhammad, we are bound by this Quran so that we could hamd sana of Allah? No. Whatever we say to Allah becomes hamd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whatever we say, whatever we speak to Allah, that becomes naat and hamd of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Mm-hmm. We are not bound to have this any book or any word or any guidance before us so we can communicate to Allah.
Mm-hmm.
So Prophet used to go there in the Hira cave and used to sit there and speak, talk to Allah and look at the Kaaba and whatnot.
Mm-hmm.
One of the day he was sitting there and Jibreel came and said, Prophet, this is the time, one jashid al-Qalabin, now go and tell your family members about yourself. And the worst, the famous ayat was revealed, Iqra, Bismi Rabbika Allazi Khalaq.
Khalaq, yes.
Yeah, so this Iqra is not that you read from now. It was that go and read in front of them. Tell them that Allah has told you. Go and read in front of them. So then Prophet came down to Khadija Salamullah Alaiha and he told her that today I am given the permission or the order from Allah to go and tell the people what I am. And Khadija Salamullah said, Muhammad, go and do whatever you ask to do and you will see me up behind you. And then from the house of Khadija, he went to the house of Abu Talib and he said, uncle, I'm going to start my mission. So where should I start? And Abu Talib said, I'm with you and my son Ali is with you.
Wow.
And Abu Talib was the one who arranged all the Zul Ashira, and on his money it was organized and funded, the Zul Ashira. Yes. So then Prophet said that, come to me, I am the Prophet, follow me. And then one of the mushrikeen said to Abu Talib that you used to follow Muhammad and now you will follow your son Ali. You always be a follower.
They so, ridiculed him for
yeah,
that. Yeah,
yeah. So it was just the because they had nothing to say else. I mean, they had no religion. They had no statement. They had no religion, no ground. So all they could do is this kind of
it's
stuff.
Ridicule, yeah. The ridicule.
Mm-hmm. So, but Prophet didn't lose anything else. I mean, he didn't give up. It was just a start.
Mm-hmm.
And coming to the question, there what message we get from prophets from today's, from tonight's event, that he was the Mab'ath from the night of Mab'ath. He was one person in the mission, and so he was only one. He did not have a shura, he did not have Saqifa, where he had so many people and they would sit and decide he's our leader and we all follow him. No, he was just one person. The first person he went down was Khadija, his wife. The second person he went was Abu Talib and his son. So these things, step by step, give us a message that no matter if you are one, Wallahu yasibuka minan nas, if you are on the way of Allah, if you're on the path of Allah, Allah will protect you from the people.
Definitely.
Yeah, and number one. Number two, trust your family members, trust your people. So he went to the Khadija. Instead of going to the Makkah straight away, asking,
yes,
he went to his family, Ahlul Bayt. Khadija, I'm giving this responsibility. What should I do?
Mm-hmm.
She would say that, yeah, I'm behind you. Go and do whatever you want to do, and I'm sitting next to you.
Mm-hmm.
And then he went to the family members, extended family, Abu Talib and Ali and all those. So these step-by-step actions of Prophet will give us the lesson that no matter one, if you are one, no matter how hard the mission you are going to, keep your sincere people with you.
Definitely.
If you have trustworthy people next to you, if you have solid grounds of your mission, no matter if you are one or two or three or five, you will be successful. So I think Mab'ath is actually the start of Islamic teachings.
Yes.
And those who are mutamassik from the first day, they stayed mutamassik till the last day. Those who left Prophet in the middle way, of course, they were not mutamassik on the first day as well. Those who say, yes, Prophet, we do believe you are Prophet, but Quran says some of them, there were those who said, yes, we do believe you are Prophet Muhammad, but Quran said the iman has not entered in their hearts, mm-hmm, because they were munafiqeen.
Yes.
So we have to bear both kind of people, the mu'minin, yes, and the munafiqeen. So this is also a message that no matter how successful a person can be, you cannot be a prophet. I cannot be a prophet.
Yes.
You cannot be as high as Prophet was. I cannot be. If he, being a Muhammad, being a prophet, being the king of universe, could be surrounded with a mu'min and munafiq, of course, every person can be.
Mm-hmm.
So don't give up even if you're surrounded by the munafiqeen and the people.
I mean, and that's one of the key things that really solves the problems that we have today. The majority of the youth, the majority of you know, every single person, whether they're old or young, they're hesitant to give back to the community. They're hesitant to even help the community. They're hesitant to think positively because of their peers, that peer pressure them into doing certain things. Prophet Muhammad came out there by himself, and as you mentioned, began with the people close to him. That gives us, this is number one, that gives us a message that really change comes from within yourself. And then you can change the community.
Yeah, of course,
it doesn't change as it come, it go inwards, it goes outwards.
Outward,
it gets from you, and then it goes out to your wife, your son, Abu Talib, just like what the Prophet did. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And sorry, if you want to comment on that, and then I have a second point.
Yeah, I just want to mention something. It's not a comment about this thing. Just want to mention something because today the world is changing. Every day we get new things coming up to the people, to the youth. So many of our brothers and sisters living in West, because I live in London, I know. I go to Europe, I know what people are doing and going through these days. So many of our young brothers, they are having some fears of keeping a beard, the Sharia Islamic beard.
Why? Now it's a trend, now it's a style.
For a few years. After this, something else will come up.
Yeah.
And similarly, some of our sisters, because they go to university, they go to college, they go to work, they think that if we start wearing hijab and we abaya and all that, the our friends, our circle, they will not like it. They will make fun of it. Let them do it. The people did not leave Prophet. They made fun of him. They even called him Alayhi Billah, he was Majnoon. They called him poet. They called him all sorts of names. He didn't give up. So even if you are going to college, university, you are wearing a hijab and you think that your colleagues are going to make fun of you, let them do it.
Stay firm to your
will. Yes, stay firm to your will. And believe me, if a person is strong enough with their grounds and their beliefs, those people who they're making fun today, tomorrow they'll come to you.
He will change their hearts.
Of course.
And that's what the Prophet did. He showed them what his heart, how pure his heart is, and his pure intentions. They had to submit to him. They had to submit to whatever he was saying. The second thing that the Prophet brought, or Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was trying to tell the Prophet to tell us, was iqra. A lot of people say iqra, read.
Yeah, all right, read.
I read, okay. Yeah. But there's a message behind that. That really, I say that, you know, numerous of times, a lot of times. Iqra. I think the purpose behind that, and I read it in Al-Majlisi's Bihar Al-Anwar, and he touches upon that a little bit, where he says, the word iqra, basically, the word iqra shows how important education is. Is that if you come to a nation, an ignorant nation, you don't come to them in wars, in bribery, you don't come to them in lies, jokes, and you know, these things that society's filled, mashallah, with today. You know, you come to them with education, you educate them to become better individuals. I think that's why the word iqra was revealed to the Prophet.
Of course, and it was the first word.
First divine,
and Prophet Allah, this is the first word, iqra, go and read, go and study, go and get yourself educated. And Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Ana Madinatul Ilm, wa aliyun babuha. He could have said, Ana Madinatul Nabuwa, Ana Madinat, yani,
knowledge.
He could say anything
he
else.
He showed us the importance of knowledge.
He could say anything
else.
Am Madinatul Rahma, Am Madinatul Qadha. No, he said, Am Madinatul Ilm. I am the city of knowledge. Why? So you, if you want to be a real follower of me, get educated. And I must say that today we, some of our brothers and sisters, you including myself, we feel very proud having, for example, iPhone 7. We are having Samsung S8.
I have an iPhone 6.
You have a 6, yeah. Some people have iPhone 7, some have S6, 8, or whatever the new gadgets they are. They feel very proud. They take selfies. Okay, a person who manufactured iPhone 7, he actually is the ruler of the world. He made one device and make everyone go to his door and to buy it. And how do you do it with education? This is not a point of to be proud that I have this latest device. The real person who deserves the pride is the one who invented it. We are very good composer, typer, we can do very good composing on the internet, we can do all sort of this, we can play with all these sort of gadgets. We shouldn't be proud on this that we know how to do it. The person who should be proud, the one who invented it. We ride Ferrari, probably you ride Ferrari or something.
I
have Toyota Avensis, by the way.
I test drive one, but I don't really own one. No.
Yeah, but. And for example, if you drive a Ferrari and you say, yeah, I have a Ferrari and I bought it for $500,000, there's nothing to be proud of. The real person who should be proud of the one who made Ferrari and made you give him money so you can get his product.
That makes sense.
Yeah, so how did he do it? With education. He had, you know, in the education, you could be a good industrialist, maybe, by accident, but you cannot be a good inventor by accident. You have to have some education. Islam is not invention, Islam is a religion. But Islam does not restrict men or women from getting education. Talabul ilm faridun ala kulli muslimin wa muslimat.
Yes.
Everyone, whether you are a Muslim woman or Muslim man, you must, fariza, you must go and educate yourself. And this is the only reason that you can be a real follower. An ignorant cannot be a follower of Prophet. An ignorant, ana madinatul ilm, I am the city of knowledge. An ignorant cannot live in a city where the title of the knowledge is.
Yes.
So similarly, a Yazidi cannot live in Karbala. As far as Yazidi cannot live in Karbala, he cannot be Husseini. A Jahil cannot be a follower of Madinatul Ilm.
Hopefully we can continue this by another occasion. Thank you very much for joining us tonight. Respected viewers, thank you very much for tuning in tonight. Hopefully we can continue this in another occasion. They're cutting me off. They're telling me this and this. But we'll continue this, inshallah, another occasion. Thank you very much. Wassalamu alaikum. Rahmatullahi.
Barakatuh. Take care.
بی تو دلم چون شب تاره، بی تو جهان نوری نداره، هرچی که دارم نظر یاره، هرچی که دارم نظر یاره. مددی یا رسول الله، مددی یا رسول الله، مددی یا رسول الله، مددی یا رسول الله.